Hello and welcome. Please enjoy this short readiness video on Azure Database for MySQL. Good morning, Jan. How are you doing?
I'm doing very well, Sanjay. How are you doing?
Great. Great to have you here with us.
My pleasure.
So what do you do at Microsoft?
I'm a product manager in the open source databases team, and I run the PM team for the MariaDB and MySQL services.
I see. So let's get started. What are you going to talk about?
Yeah. So I was thinking, share some thoughts on how customers can approach how they size their database servers for their workloads appropriately to essentially, as you already introduced, get the most performance out of the database service. And then the second piece, I want to talk a little bit on, like, when you have the database server ready to go, right, then it's still important how do you connect to it, right? Because there's also a bunch of stuff that you need to look at. And I want to share some thoughts on both of those and hopefully get everybody set up for success.
Let's dive in.
All right.
So, of course, the first question always is, like, how do customers best figure out, you know, what's the right size?
Yeah, so it really comes down to you have to know your workload, right? And there's no way around it because every workload is different. And there are a couple of questions that you really need to ask yourself about your workload. So one is, hey, is it I/O intensive? The second one, is it compute intensive? Yeah. The I/O intensive piece, what you need typically is you need to make sure that your storage solution is beefy enough, right? You have enough IOPS. Size is typically somewhat secondary. Right, but the performance that you get out of the size is the important piece, right? So how many IOPS do you have provisioned? And then depending on the mix of your workload, is it very write-heavy versus very read-heavy, you may make different choices for the compute, actually. So if you have a very write-intensive workload, then having beefy storage is most important. If you have a very read-heavy workload, you can also consider getting, for example, a memory-optimized offering, so you have more data in memory and actually need less I/O. So there are some trade-offs in this one.
I see.
And yeah, it really depends, again, on what your workload is. The second piece on the compute side of things, one is you do need compute to drive I/O, for example. Right? So it's not only do you do a lot of calculations in memory or do you have a lot of math running, aggregation, stuff like this, but it's also about, hey, how many resources do you need to drive the network, to drive the I/O? Like, so all of these come together.
I see.
And then once you have a starting point, ultimately you need to figure out for your workload, like, what do you really want to achieve, right? And this is where, you know your workload, know what you want to get out of it is super important. Because, hey, you know, you may run a query, it takes 10 minutes, and that's okay for you, right? Where someone else runs a query, and it should come back in a few milliseconds.
CEO right? queries, so it's, for example.
Exactly, yeah. And so it's very different, right? So, but you need to know what your workload is, right? And then you make the trade-offs for your workload. And then the last piece, Parichit, I believe, earlier in one of the earlier sessions, touched on it a little bit. Given our quick scaling capabilities, you can right-size your workload even when you are already in production. So a couple good examples of these ones are, like, if you have a, you know, your workload is typically busy during work hours.
So let's say a retail example.
Yeah, well, oh yeah, like retail, obviously, in the holiday season, a good example, right? So if you know you have a big event coming up, like we just had Thanksgiving here, Black Friday, Cyber Monday, obviously super popular in the United States, and I hear it's making its splash around the world also. If you know you have this event coming up, you scale up for this event, you make sure you have the resources available to handle this peak workload, right? And then later on, you can go back down when you know, hey, you go back to, you know, business as usual, right? But then keep in mind Christmas is coming.
So. Yeah, that's exactly. Okay, that's exciting, of course.
Yeah.
So you have live demo for us.
Yeah, let's have a look at a little bit of this one. So what you can see here on the screen, Sanjay, is on the left-hand side, there's a workload running. Okay. And so all these green little fields and zeros are black. But the green pieces around it, those are queries running against a MySQL server that I've provisioned. And all these queries do very, very big updates. So think of multi-megabyte updates against a single table. And you can see the average milliseconds that this takes is around 30,000 at the moment. And we're getting about, you know, 0.5 transactions per second on this workload against our server. So now if we switch here to the browser, you will see this is a metric that I'm showing for I/O percent, and you're seeing we're running at like about 80%, and let's hit refresh also to get the latest. You see it's very stable, but essentially we're maxing out on I/O here. So what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna go to the pricing tier blade where we can scale these things dynamically, and what I wanna do is I'm just gonna move the storage slider up and give it more power. Okay. and click OK, and what you will observe.
So you get more storage, not recourse.
Exactly. Yeah, I just do storage, okay. Right? Because we give you IOPS per gigabyte provision. So we give you 3 IOPS per gigabyte, right? And if you move up the storage, you can see in this particular region where I am right now, we don't yet have the 16 terabyte support, but it goes up to 4 terabyte and about 6,000 IOPS. So I just took a number above that. And what you will see is that more or less instantly, without any disruption, the workload will get faster. So let's have a look. I'll click OK up here, down here,
yes. And
go back to the workload. And you will see very quickly that the transactions per second number will go up, and then the average latency of the workload will go down. So you can already see the increase, right? Zero disruption to the workload.
Yeah.
And this will go up to about 6 or so transactions per second. And again, I mean, there's no magic. It's a huge update, right? So it will take some time, but the latency will go down to something in the order of 4 seconds. So you can see it's a gigantic difference, yes, by just making sure you have the right amount of storage.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Wow, that's quite a difference.
Yeah.
So how do customers do this?
Sanjay, I mean, as I already said, it's all about knowing your workload, and you have to test it. And it's super important that you test it with the workload that you are, or basically a workload that represents your actual production workload. Ideally, you have a test environment where you simulate users against your environment that then generates the workload against the database. Because Yep. Then, one, you get a very true representation of your workload against the database itself, right? But you also get actually an end-to-end testing of your entire application. And in the second set, when we talk about latency, this will become important. And then, what you do, once you get this, like you do the initial sizing, you get the workload running, and then you can look at some of the metrics that we expose. And maybe let me just switch back
real
quick to the demo here and look at some of those metrics. So for example here, like I already showed you the I/O percentage,
yeah,
right? So this is just a different view on the same server for CPU. And you can see actually my example, CPU is also fairly heavily used,
yes,
even though it's just updates.
Yeah.
The reason is because we generate all this I/O.
Yeah.
And so probably would be a good idea for me to scale the compute up for this workload as well to get even more power out of the database server. Okay. The second cool thing is we have we brought the intelligent performance feature set that we have for SQL Server. We brought this to MySQL as well.
Okay.
So what you can do is you can, for your server, go in and turn on what's called the query store. And the query store lets you capture telemetry of your queries over time. And it stores it over time so that you can look over time what was happening to your server. So you just switch on a couple of parameters here that I highlighted, and then you can go to the Query Performance Insights tab in the portal and have a look at it. And so what you see here is essentially the queries that have been running. I ran it since last night against this server, and you can see, you know, the 40 seconds that we saw on the test as well, and you can see it over time. And you can see, you know, at the bottom here which queries were running. And the cool thing is you can also look at the wait statistics for this one to figure out, you know, what am I actually bottlenecked on those queries?
These do look like perform on count in SQL.
Oh, yeah. It's the exact same thing, right? All database engines have this.
And
we don't do anything, any magic here, right? So those are the built-in MySQL ones. We just expose them here, and you can look at them, and you can see, we're waiting for I/O, right, for fetching the I/O. There's no surprise in this. Obviously, this also helps you if you want to troubleshoot individual queries, stuff like this, right? So it's not only for the initial sizing, but also tuning your workload.
I see.
Of
course. These are very cool insights. Now, what else can customers do to get best performance?
Yeah, so the second piece is really how do you connect to your database, right? Because essentially, like any network adds latency, right? And the second piece that a lot of people don't actually think about is when you open a new connection, that's a very expensive operation because there's authentication involved, there's a session needs to be spun up on the database server, right? So those two together can make a big difference in your end-to-end performance, right? And this is what I was saying earlier. Ideally, you have a test setup where you have a client that generates workload against your middle tier or your front end, depending, and then look at the end-to-end experience. And so now, the most obvious thing to do is, you know, pack them into the same region, right?
There's
a little bit like, of course, but, you know, really do it. Like, make sure they're in the same region, because that obviously makes a gigantic difference.
Mm-hmm.
The second piece is, for Azure VMs, we have what is called accelerated networking on those Azure VMs. And so that's more like a client-side optimization.
Yes.
But it ultimately, what it does, it bypasses some of the VM overhead that you have for the network or in the network stack.
Yes.
And makes a big difference in the end-to-end latency when you connect to the database server. Then you should definitely try to avoid many network hops, right? So, like, yeah, you may put a cache in the middle, but you know, don't do multiple levels of indirection because every single one adds latency. And then lastly, lose connection pooling, right? Because like again, I said like the establishing a connection is very expensive, right? So ideally, you don't want to do this. Just establish the connection and let the system reuse it, right? So that's really that's a very important one. And on the MySQL side, we know there's some, not every language environment has connection pooling. There's some tools for this one. One of them is Proxy SQL that you can use to do this for you. Can co-locate it with your application, just connect to this Proxy SQL, and it does the connection pooling for you. It's very important.
Yeah. Awesome. So I have a frequently asked question for you, really.
Yeah.
It's like, customers should avoid hops, and of course, we always think that way too.
Yeah.
But isn't the gateway mentioned earlier essentially an additional hop?
It is. You're very right there. Yeah. So the gateway that we use for our high availability is a hop. The good news is we're working on bypassing this one. And so basically what we're doing is we're working on client drivers that allow you to bypass the gateway with every subsequent connection after you establish the first connection. So basically what it does is the client connects to the gateway, gets the information from the gateway where your database server is currently hosted in the backend.
Yeah.
And then from there on, every new connection goes directly to the database engine and you cut this hop out. And so we're going to have this first for PHP and then for Java. So for PHP, it's an add-on to the driver that you can install with Packl. And for Java, we have this in the MariaDB connector for Java. So that obviously works with MySQL as well because it's the same protocol. Just get that one once we have it upstream to the community, and then you're good to go. And you don't need to do anything. It's completely transparent for the application. And maybe let me hop in and show you the difference. I have it set up here, and what you can see, it's similar to the workload before. Right now, I'm just running one connection.
Yeah.
Because ultimately, I want to do a network test, and the connection just does a select one, so it really only tests the network. And you can see on the top one, this is the one that goes through our gateway.
Okay.
And it takes about 1.8 milliseconds or so, which is overall is actually what we expect to see, and it's not bad. Right? But you can see at the bottom one, if you bypass the gateway, you can cut this time in, more than half.
More than half.
So it's 0.6 milliseconds. And the consequence out of this one is you get 3x the transactions per second. Now, obviously, it's a select one. It doesn't do anything, right? So if you have a query running that takes 10 minutes to complete, well, maybe that's not that important for you, right? But especially chatty applications that do like point lookups, need stuff very fast, this is where this will hopefully give a big benefit to customers.
All right.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Jan. Any other closing thought?
No, I got a couple of resources on the last slide here. Our service homepage, absolutely, customers can reach out to us and ask questions. These emails actually come directly to the product team, and we answer them typically within a day or so, minus weekends.
Yes.
Reach out. We have a great tech community, a blog, a page on Azure where you can get the latest updates, latest tips and tricks from us.
Thank you so much for all this great information
and Sanjay,
amazing
thanks for
demos. All demos worked for you as well.
Oh, yeah.
Thanks for watching this short Azure Readiness video.